Here, we're gonna fly in the area where you should have the cooling pumps of the facility, so what is supposed to cool down the reactor.
It was 1:23 a.m. on April 26th, 1986.
The worst nuclear accident in history.
A routine test at the Chernobyl nuclear plant went horribly wrong.
The first question that we ask ourselves is the area radioactive and is it dangerous for the pilot and for the team?
The disaster threw radioactive fallout across a huge area.
They needed the image to prove that those areas were clean of any radioactive material.
The area around Chernobyl is still an exclusion zone.
It's really amazing to be able to walk in a city that have been completely abandoned in a matter of days. The atmosphere was really weird. It really feels like a haunted town. I'm Charles Ray, and I was a pilot that flew the drone in Chernobyl. The melting of Reactor 4 happened in 1986, so 35 years ago. We were supposed to do a demonstration in just one of the buildings outside of Chernobyl to be able to show the technology and show that it could be useful. And actually, it's when we got on site that people asked us, can you help us out and do actually a real inspection for us in the reactor number 5 to be able to prove and capture data that would show that there is no nuclear waste stored in those areas. One of the engineers on site said they are okay to fly inside Chernobyl, so as long as it's safe for them and for the drone, let's give it a try. I was the only pilot for this mission in Chernobyl. I had a co-pilot to help me for the direction, and we have the engineers and the security guys that were following us during the full day. The first question that we ask ourselves is the area radioactive and is it dangerous for the pilot and for the team that went there? But the first thing the people from the site gave us was a sensor on each of us, and we had to make sure that we were not flying in highly radioactive places inside the site. We usually start with a reconnaissance flight, in which we just want to have a general feeling of the environment to see if the stability would work well, to see how far can we go without losing the signal, how much time it takes to get to the inspection point and back. So here we are flying through one of the cranes that should have been dismantled after they finished to build the facility. But as they never finished to build it, they never removed it. In here you can see that it was really not finished and they really stopped working on it overnight. So the three holes here on the ground is where you should have the cooling water pump. So here we are in another flight. You can see the lead shade here on the floor is where would have been the center of the reactor. Here you would have had some liquid where we are right now. Here you can see the ceiling, and that should be the ground zero of the facility. And the square here, you can see what was supposed to be the cooling pool in which they would put the radioactive material after they have been in use. They are stored here for a couple of weeks or months to be able to cool down before you can store them safely outside of the facility. When we are looking straight down, you will see the cage of the drone is what you can see at the bottom of the screen. And here I'm trying to collect data without having the cage in the field of vision. Then I move the camera straight down, and this is the cooling pool in which I will fly down. So we could prove that those pools were completely empty and that there were no radioactive material that had been stored in those cooling pools. The main difficulty in this flight was that we were flying relatively far away and that there was a lot of concrete between us and the pool that we wanted to inspect. So we had to see if the signal would go through, and luckily the roof of Chernobyl of the facility was in steel. So actually the signal of the remote control would bounce on the ceiling, and this allows us to fly from the bottom part of a reactor all the way up through a pool that was even under us. On the tablet, you have a sensor that will tell you the signal strength between the drone and the remote control. Every time you have to do an inspection or a flight in an area in which you know that if you lose the signal with the drone or if you run out of battery, you cannot recover the drone, it's always a bit more stressful. And you have to do that with a couple of inspectors looking over your shoulder. So it really doesn't help for the stress. I collect the data with the instruction of the inspector on where to fly and what kind of data we need to capture. There were no alternatives than using the drone to be able to capture those data. The piloting team of Liability have the opportunity to travel all around the world to be able to do those demonstration and those inspection. In the past few years, we had the opportunity to participate in an adventure mission in Greenland, in which we were exploring glacier and trying to get data about the global warming. The Greenland ice sheet are the second biggest ice sheet in the world after Antarctica. And that mission took us in some of the deepest ice cave in the world. The purpose was to be able to go fly inside a glacier and see how the area had melted and what was the impact of the global warming. So they wanted to see if there were any life, so any bacteria or anything like that. Due to the global warming, it wasn't really safe to send people at this time of the year. So we actually sent the drone and flew it about 140 meters down in those chutes to be able to collect data. And we actually found a frozen lake at the bottom. Indoor drones can really allow you to go and fly the drone in confined space, more or less everywhere. It is already used to fly in mines, we can fly in caves. There is actually no real limit. It is an adventure to be able to explore those places that haven't been seen in years.